going to turn the world upside down. And that's what Daniel told to me when he came home from kindergarten a few years ago. And he sure did. Dr. King's strong belief in nonviolent protest set the tone of the civil rights movement and changed the country's views on race and segregation in the 1950s and 60s. Even his words today are poignant and relevant and sought after in making this country a better place for all. King said, quote, "I look to a day when people will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character." He also said, "I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear." And he also has said, "Faith is taking the first step, even when you don't see the whole staircase." Dr. King was called. He was called to be a preacher and a teacher. He was called to turn the world upside down. He was called to use his gifts to share a story of love that expressed hope for what could be. During King's junior year in high school, Morehouse College, a respected historically black college, announced that it would accept any high school juniors who could pass its entrance exam. At that time, many students had abandoned further studies to enlist in World War II, and due to this, Morehouse was eager to fill its classrooms. At the age of 15, King passed the exam and entered Morehouse. The summer before his last year at Morehouse in 1947, the 18-year-old King chose to enter the ministry. He had concluded that the church offered the most assuring way to answer, quote, "an inner urge to serve humanity." King's inner urge had begun developing, and he made peace with the Baptist Church, as he believed he would be a rational minister with sermons that were a specific force for ideas, even social protest. He did all this not because he had to. He did so because he wanted to. It filled his soul. It was his passion. It became his vocation. It was his calling. We rarely speak about callings anymore. Call stories. What makes you do what you do? What feeds your spirit? Dr. King's legacy speaks of his call to the ministry as a way to serve humanity. We heard Samuel's call story this morning, a story filled with confusion, doubt, and accountability. And perhaps we can relate to that. I know I sure can. When it comes to call stories, Samuel's is mine, or at least one that I can lean into to describe my call to ministry. My call from God came when I was 14 years old on the day of my confirmation. Though I did not know it then, and before my family and friends, I sobbed when I chose to accept the vows of baptism as my own during my confirmation and wondered, why am I so overcome with emotion? Church was a place where I felt accepted and loved, and I was given many opportunities to share in leadership by teaching Sunday school, reading scripture, volunteering at funeral luncheons. It was in my junior year at UW-Madison when my pastor at the time asked me to lead worship, and I didn't even bat an eye and said, "Of course, I'd love to do so." And it felt really good. I felt like I was at home, and I felt like I had something to contribute. However, at that time, my sights were set on something far different. I wanted to go to medical school. I wanted to be a doctor. Specifically, I wanted to be a doctor, a family physician in a rural community, because it's where I knew. It was my people. I knew the ways of rural living. It was in that same year, though, when God was really calling. Sarah, Sarah. And I go running to my college advisor and ask all the questions I needed to know about which classes I should be taking in that moment. And then I hear, Sarah. Oh, Sarah. And I go running back to my college advisor. Okay, so what classes do I need to take to get into med school? Okay. And then finally, Sarah. Oh, sweet Jesus, Sarah, would you just respond? And that time, I went running to my pastor. And that time, I asked him about what it was like to be a pastor and where they went to seminary and what their experience was like. That was in November of 1999, my senior year in college, where I had declared my major with medical microbiology and immunology, a bachelor's of science, was trending to go into a different direction, had taken my MCAT, all this. And at the end of that semester, I had a strong inclination I would be attending United Theological Seminary of the Twin Cities. And in January 2000, I was accepted into the Master's of Divinity program at UTS. Once that acceptance came, I went to my college advisor, Dr. Shell, and told him I was going to into the ministry, and his response was, I'm not surprised. Those are those moments when people see something in you, you need to say something. My family's response was much the same. Of course, Sarah, that makes so much sense. Why didn't somebody say something? But then, someone was trying to say something. I finally heard, Sarah, Sarah. And after putting aside all my perceived goals, I could say with confidence, okay, God, here I am. You called me. And this moment reminds me of an article written by Paul Keim, who wrote, quote, every call to something may also be a call away from something. I said goodbye to a call of healing the physical body, but said yes to a call of being with folks and healing the spiritual wholeness and prayer and compassion. Oftentimes, however, we only speak of a call when it is directly linked to a ministry or a teaching or a way to utilize the bulk of working hours. What would happen, though, if we began speaking about our call, God's call to us, in a way that utilized our gifts and our faith as an expression of hope in a world needing to discern what hope looks like? What would happen if we began to see that God calls each of us in different ways to serve so that we are able to hear a word of joy and turn it into song? We are able to hear and to see that God's call is not simply reserved for the preacher or the Christian educator or a teacher at a religious school. God's call is intended for all and for all of us as a way to serve, using our gifts given. Do you hear it? Do you even want to hear it? And are you ready to hear it? Because folks, God is always calling, I'm convinced. Whether we are wanting to admit it or not, whether we are ready or not, it is that still small voice that grounds us, that awakens us, that fills us to our fullest potential. Do you hear it? The season after the Epiphany, the time between Christmastide and Lent, is that occasion to reflect upon God's coming into the world through Jesus the Christ, the light of the world. When we diminish the possibility of one being called, are we in reality also dimming this light which would seek to transform not only individuals but communities of faith? This alone is a hard juxtaposition to find ourselves in currently. Having just arrived to witness a humble birth filled with hope, peace, joy, and love, to now preach the strain of the prophets with a message to notice, to hear, to listen. And yet we were certainly called to notice Jesus' birth by following that star in the night sky, to hear Herod's response to such a birth and Mary's acknowledgement, let alone ours, that Jesus was God in human form. What an epiphany. What a calling. God's call is life-changing, transformational, and full of struggle. If it were all puppies and roses, people might actually treat people a whole lot better, wouldn't they? The season after the Epiphany is a good time to look at the epiphanies in our lives, the calls that take place. It is also a good reminder that even the prophets of old needed to remember that God calls. The first verse from 1 Samuel says it best. Now, the boy Samuel was ministering to God under Eli. The word of God was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. Well, they may have been. Samuel and Eli were not always listening for a whole variety of reasons. The possibilities for people to think and reflect and respond to calls are endless, and sometimes a whole bunch of stuff needs to happen first in order for us to discern what in fact happened and how that even relates to God and faith and hope and all that holy stuff that surrounds us. For me, it was doing really bad on that MCAT exam to finally notice I'm thinking somebody else is calling and I need to really lean into that. The song we heard this morning could have been sung by Samuel after his call from God. God knows us inside and out. God knit us together in the womb. This psalm is sometimes referred to as a creation song. I think it is, and I think it is another reminder of God's presence from the beginning and through our life. God walks with us even when God is calling, and we may not even be listening. We are, quote, not mass-produced, but custom-made, James Lindbergh writes in his commentary on the Psalms. He tells the story about young Rabbi Zusa, who was quite discouraged about his failures and weaknesses. Said an older rabbi to him, "When you get to heaven, God is not going to say to you, 'Why weren't you Moses?' No, God will say, 'Why weren't you Zusa?' So why don't you stop trying to be Moses and start being the Zusa God created you to be?" Which also implies, once again, that God calls us, uses us and the gifts given to us to make this place a little bit better. And as Dr. King said, to turn the world upside down and to be the people that God created us to be. Do you hear it? God is here, busy at work, coloring, cutting, singing, praying, playing. God is revealing God's self and inviting epiphanies and inviting us into discernment to use our gifts and abilities to speak of hope for a world that is made out of love. So here we are. Your people are doing their best to listen. May it be so.